Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is Sunday, August 5th, 2018. This is the 11th Sunday after Pentecost. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. Our pastor is the Reverend John H. Pollock. Our organist is Greg Nolte.
Thank you. Please turn to page 147 in the front of the picture. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia.
Moses said to them, "It is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat." word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent.
So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us then, so we may see it and believe? What work are you performing?" "Our ancestors had manna in the wilderness, as it is written. He gave them bread from heaven to eat." Then Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. What announcement to share with you, and that is there will be no Wednesday night service this week. Jim and I will be with you on the way up to Northwest Indiana to pick up Katie, Jack, and Ben and bring them out to spend the week with us, which we've had them for a week in the summer, about 2 years, because of the crazy softball schedule. Katie and Jack were involved in it. So no Wednesday night service this Wednesday, but we'll pick up the following. Let us now say, "Lord, speak to us that we may speak," at number 676. Good number 676.
They're following him.
promotion or office. They're following him because it looks good to their employer, especially if they still are working in a situation that's owned by a local family. Like most businesses are today, and grocery stores and everything else. Back in the 19th century, 18th century, early 20th century, there were towns and cities where the business was locally owned, and if you went to church, the owner was more likely to promote you if you keep that out, you didn't go to church. And weren't a believer, you stayed at the bottom for your entire career. So why, for what reason, are you following Jesus? There are those who follow Jesus because it looks good. There are those who follow Jesus because it's the tradition of their family. As far back as they can trace their family always went to church. But they now live in the modern 21st century with all the things going on that can pull you away from Christ. They continue to go because they don't want to break that tradition. They think Jesus was a nice fella. They think he taught good values, but they really don't look upon him as Savior. Or others go to church because if they don't, grandma's going to write them out of the will. Absolutely. So they don't need one written out of grandma's will so they can go to church. Well, in our gospel reading for this morning, we see Jesus actually rejecting people because of their lack of faith. Now, we like to say that Jesus is love, that Jesus loves everyone, and he does. But that doesn't necessarily mean he accepts everybody, that they are not coming to him on the proper terms. So we go back to our gospel lesson today, the 6th chapter of John. If you haven't been with us the past week or two, the 6th chapter of John begins with the end of the disciples having been sent out by Jesus 2 by 2 to preach the gospel, heal the sick, and so forth. And they've come back all excited, cast out demons, we did this and did that. He said, well, come, let's go and rest for a while. Let's withdraw from the crowds. Just have a time of rest and relaxation. The only problem is people find out where they are. And as we read in the Gospel of John, 5,000 people come chasing after Jesus and the disciples. It's late in the afternoon. Jesus realizes that people need something to eat. And so he asks Philip. He says, Philip, where are we going to get enough food to feed all these people? Philip says, Lord, 6 months' wages wouldn't buy enough food to fill all these people, to feed all these people. And then Andrew says, Lord, he said, I got a little boy here who brought his lunch with me. He's got 5 loaves and 2 fish. But what's that about all these people? Tells the disciples that have meals today. They break it down in groups. Jesus takes the little boy's lunch, blesses it, and 12 basketfuls of bread are collected after they eat. Well, the people are so excited about this that they want to make Jesus king, and Jesus realizes this. So he sends the disciples across the lake to Capernaum while he goes up in the mountains away from the people. People spend the night. During the night, the disciples are going across the lake, but they're not making much progress. Suddenly, Jesus comes walking on the water to them, gets in the boat immediately comes to the earth. That morning, when as we read in today's gospel reading, the crowd sees Jesus is gone, the disciples are gone, so they get in the boat and come to the earth, following after Jesus. And then we read how they come upon Jesus and they ask, they say, Rabbi, when did you come here? And of course, as so often with Jesus, he doesn't answer their question, but instead responds with some very important words. He says, you are truly, truly, I say to you, you are seeking me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. In other words, far too many preachers, many very popular, who preach this so-called prosperity gospel, no gospel at all. But they preach this idea that, well, first of all, they take a verse out of context, out of the Bible, and twist it around and make you believe that if you do what they say, that you're going to become rich, or you're going to obtain that position you want, or you're going to become famous, you're going to have power. Yet that's not what Jesus tells us of. Here he's scolding these people for following him for what they can gain materially instead of seeing who he really is, the Messiah, the Savior of the world. Back in the 60s and 70s into the 80s, maybe even the 90s, there was a fellow who was on the radio. I don't remember ever seeing him make it on TV, but he was on the radio. And he would tell people if they would send money to him, he would send them this prayer shawl. And if they would put this shawl over when they prayed, they'd get whatever they wanted. And on this radio program, he'd have people standing up there and testifying, oh, I got Reverend so-and-so's prayer shawl, and I got my new Cadillac, and I got this new home, and everything was material. There's nothing about salvation. There was nothing about how they had the forgiveness of sins. Nothing about they had the promise of eternal life. It was all material. One parish I served, there was a folk member of the parish whose name was on the roll. Nobody saw him for years until he announced he was running for sheriff. From the time he announced he was running from sheriff, until the day he was elected, he was in church every Sunday. Once he got elected, they didn't see him for the next 4 years. He had to sit out at that time 4 years. Sheriffs could be reelected as the governor. One person he re-elected was a county judge at the time, Commonwealth, I can tell you. So he sat out 4 years and then ran again. Now he's in front, he shows up in church. Election goes on, he's in church. Then he's elected. Last time he saw him in church. He was never there when I was there 11 years. He never broke the middle of the church. So he was using Jesus in order to be able to fill the office. And that's what Jesus is talking about. You're not chasing after me because of who I really am. You're chasing after me because you think you're going to get something material. They will receive something. Forgiveness and eternal life and bring us to you in hand. But they're not interested in that. Do not work, brothers. Do not toil. Do not labor. Do not perform deeds for the food that perishes, that is destroyed, that is lost, that is killed. But for the food that endures, that is to remain, to dwell, to abide, to stand firm, to last, that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you, will bestow upon you, or commit to you, deliver to you, for on him God the Father has set his seal. For on him God has attested to the fact he is his Son. The word also means to stand something. With a ring of authority. The ancient world, kings and governors and so forth, wear what's called a signet ring. You put wax on the paper or whatever, and stamp their ring with a seal, and then it is official. So it's saying God has put his seal on Jesus, just like God puts his seal on us through the waters of baptism. We are baptized. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And when you say you receive the sign of the cross, and the sign of the cross on the forehead of that time, we are sealed by Jesus Christ as his child and a child of the Heavenly Father. So Jesus' promises are spiritual. They're not physical. He said, it was easier for Aunt Camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. That's not saying if you're rich, you can't go to heaven. It's saying if you put all your emphasis on your wealth and gaining more wealth instead of believing in Jesus, you have made wealth your God. And so it was. He said, why do you store up treasures on earth? Moth and rust destroy. Thieves bring it and steal. Instead, store up treasures in heaven. For moth and rust cannot destroy, and thieves cannot break these. So, to be a follower of Jesus believe in him who lead us. Same word believe that we see throughout the Gospels and the epistles, meaning to trust, to have confidence, to place your life in the hands of him. So Jesus is saying to be the work of God is to put your trust, to have confidence in, to place your life in the hands of Jesus Christ. To trust Jesus for your salvation and for your forgiveness and for the gift of eternal life. But you don't trust in anything else. You don't trust in your own works. You don't trust in ritual. You don't trust in sacrifices. You don't trust in religious rules and regulations. You trust in the atoning death of Jesus Christ upon the cross. That first Good Friday, you believe that he bodily rose on that third day from the dead, and 40 days later he ascended to heaven, where he waits to come again to judge the living and the dead. That is doing the work of God. Simple. But people always want to make it do. They try to add more things. Or again, they don't have the proper reason. Again, what Jesus is saying today, he emphasized in the Sermon on the Mount. In the Gospel of Matthew, chapters 5 through 7, we have the Sermon on the Mount. And in chapter 7, verse 21, beginning with verse 21 through 23, this is what Jesus says. Now listen carefully. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day, in judgment, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, do we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do many mighty works in your name? And then will I declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers. Not everyone who says they believe in Jesus, even if they're doing miracles and so forth, will enter the kingdom of heaven. Only those who do the will of my Father in heaven, which is the same words he now says in the Gospel of John, which has the same meaning in the Gospel of Matthew as in the Gospel of John. Doing the will of his Father, believing, trusting, having confidence in, and placing your life in the hands of Jesus Christ. For what reason are you following Jesus? Are you following Jesus because you believe he is Lord and Savior? There is no other. There's no more prophets coming. There's no more special revelations coming. There's no more books to be added. Trust, confidence in Jesus Christ. There is that faith in what Jesus has done, and that we can do nothing. Now, for what reason are you following Jesus? The reason we are following Jesus is because we confess that he is our Lord and Savior. We confess that he was born of the Virgin Mary, that he suffered under Pontius Pilate, that he was crucified, died, and was buried, that on the third day he rose again and ascended into heaven. We confess that he will come again to judge the living and the dead. And so we are doing the work of our Heavenly Father. What we have to be delivered to are those whom he was talking about in the Sermon on the Mount, who will use his name and they'll perform miracles and do all kinds of wonderful things, but they are doing it to enrich themselves. They're not doing it because they believe in Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior. They're doing this so they can have a $30,000 gold toilet. They're doing it so that they can have a yacht bigger than the Titanic. Beware of the wolves in sheep's clothing. Beware of those who say, I'm proclaiming Jesus,
who say, I'm the spokesman for the Lord. He has sent me. But he never talks about Jesus Christ. Doing the will of the Father is the reason why we follow Jesus. And that will is that we believe in Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior. That is the reason we follow Jesus. Peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus.
On the third day he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and his Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Growing in the soil of the Spirit, let us pray for the church, the world, and all who seek the richness of life in God. Our response today is, hear our prayer. Let us pray for the church, that God would lead many to eat the bread of heaven and drink the cup of salvation, never to hunger and thirst again. Gracious God, hear our prayer. Let us pray for the world, that where people know scarcity of food and water, they would also know a united effort to help them in their need. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray for those in our communities who are poor, that they would meet with compassion and assistance and opportunities for rewarding employment. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray for all who are hospitalized, all who are in chronic pain, and for all whose health is a concern. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray for the members of this congregation who volunteer with community food shelves, reading programs, and other forms of assistance, that they would be strengthened for service to all they reach. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray in thanksgiving for all who have died, that their memory may be blessed among us, and that their loved ones would be comforted in the hope of the resurrection. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
Hear us as we pray, living God, and in your mercy give us all good things for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Time for our offering. Our ushers today are Gus and Connie Singleton.
Our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
St. John practices an open communion. Followers are baptized and believe in Jesus Christ as a personal Lord and Savior. We believe his body and blood are truly present as the gift of his table. Our community and your individual congregation invited and encouraged to come forward with us this day as we gather to take the Lord. We continue our celebration with a great thanksgiving on page 152. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
O God of resurrection and new life, pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Bless this feast. Grace our table with your presence.
Come, Holy Spirit.
Reveal yourself to us in the breaking of the bread. Raise us up as the body of Christ for the world. Bring new life unto us. Send us forth burning with justice, peace, and love.
Come, Holy Spirit.
With your holy ones of all times and places, with the earth and all its creatures, with sun and moon and stars, we praise you, O God, blessed and holy Trinity, now and forever.
Amen.
Gathered in the one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus called us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Come to the banquet.
Thank you.
our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our celebration with sent forth by God's blessing in number 547 in the back of your worship. In number 547.
Our service for today. Thank you for watching us on YouTube. On Sunday mornings at 8 o'clock, our 8 o'clock service is at the Melody Cruise Drive-In Theater. Coming up Labor Day weekend will be our pet blessing. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. The food pantry is open Wednesday 9 to 10:45. The outreach store is open Monday through Friday, 9:30 to 1, closed on Thursday. Rainbow table is every Friday, noon to 1 o'clock. Everyone is welcome. Again, thank you for watching.